Morning, good morning, and thanks for tuning in today. On Facebook this week, I saw where somebody said if 2020 is perfect vision, then maybe God's using the year 2020 to correct our vision on the important things in life. Well, that may be true, I don't know. But these four songs I've chosen for you this morning remind us of who He is and how we should be. Now, the first one's entitled, It's My Desire. It was written for me by a friend of mine, Gary Eisenhower. I pray that it'll bless you. This next one reminds us about our rapture to come with Jesus. It was done by the Gaithers, called My Journey to the Sky. Now, what a great thought that is. My journey to the sky. And it'll be coming here in just a minute, I think. Hope you're doing well this morning. Hope your hair is doing better than mine is. I might get a rabies shot pretty soon, I think. There's only one thing that I long for when I reach my home on high, to see my Jesus in His glory and to reign with Him on high. I'll be so glad to see my mother who has gone gone on to that land. Oh, but I long to see my Jesus, and by his side I'll stand. Without a father, without a mother, I've had to make this journey by myself. Sometimes so friendless, heartaches seem endless, so many sorrows I have known. But I know my Lord will call me to that mansion in the sky, and I shall reign with him forever in that sweet home by and by. So many burdens have borne me, and they borne me to my knees. But then I prayed, oh blessed Jesus, won't you help me? Help me if you please. And he would hasten to my rescue. I no longer have to cry. I'll even keep my Savior with me on my journey to the sky. Well, without a father, without a mother, I've had to make this journey by myself. Sometimes so friendless, heartaches seem endless, on my journey to the sky, to the sky. Thank you so much. Well, the third one this morning relates to our troublesome times that we're going through right now. It's called Jesus is Coming Soon. It's done by the Oak Ridge Boys. Wonderful song. It's a good thought to know that Jesus is coming soon, isn't it? Get us out of all this mess. It sure is. It's coming. Woo, I'm having fun. Are you? We should. Christians can have fun, you know. Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold in, how is that stay? Humble your hearts to God, saints from the chastening rod. Seek the way pilgrims trot, Christians away. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Then he will meet the doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Trouble will soon be over, happy forevermore, when we meet on that shore, free from all care. Rising up in the sky, telling this world goodbye, homeward we then shall fly, glory to share. Oh, Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteously in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteously heavenward bound. Woo! It's another good one. We got one more on the agenda this morning. Last but not least, I'm going home to Jesus. That was done by the Nealons. What a peace it is to know that we are one day going home to Jesus. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving because it's church away. Now I'm listening to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving because it's church away. Now I'm listening to sound most any time, and the grand life that's waiting, thank God, will soon be mine. Cause I got my invitation from a place called Calvary. By the precious blood of Jesus, this trip was paid for me. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. The captain of the vessel is gonna get on board, and the destination's heaven, safe on that crystal shore. We'll meet again the Savior and the loved ones who have gone, and live for all eternity. Oh yes, I'm going home. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home to Jesus, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. Now this is your chance. Sing along with me. Come on, you know the words, just the chorus. Ready? I want to hear you. Here we go. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye, and I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I'm going home, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. So much. I apologize, my brain not working this morning, but it never does. Anyway, thank you for listening. Now be sure and tune in Brother Roger on his Facebook page to get his message for this morning. And we'll see you again tomorrow morning, Monday morning, 9:45 with more songs. I love you and I thank you for tuning in. Bye-bye.
All right. Good morning. This is Dr. Roger Bashirs, and this is Sunday morning, and this is going to be a Sunday school lesson. And I see that we have about 94 people online waiting on the Sunday school lesson. And then we'll be back on again at 11 and for another sermon. And I'm here in my home, and my wife is over there trying to fixing a barbecue chicken for lunch, and my mother-in-law is laying in there, be listening. So I've got a captive audience this morning, and it's good to have you here. I hope you survived the storms and the thunder and everything and the rain, and it's going to get worse this afternoon. So that's why I decided to do this at home. And so we're going to be studying the book of Acts. I was thinking about everything this past week, and I was, it just hit me that we need to study the book of Acts because this is about the home church and the development of the early church. And with all that we're going through right now, with everybody having to stay at home, the early church didn't have any buildings to worship in, and they met in homes, they met in the temple, they met on porches, they met by the river, they met wherever they could have a meeting place. And that's what Jesus says, where two or three are gathered together, there I am in the midst. And so that's the way the early church was. And I love the book of Acts because there's so many important things, especially even in the first chapter. There is so much that apply to our life today that we find in the first chapter of Acts. And I'm going to start there. And first of all, I want to share with you a little bit about the book of Acts. And this is something you may not have thought about, but the book of Acts has 28 chapters, but yet it has no ending because we are still in the book of Acts today, because the book of Acts is about church history. It's about the Acts of the Holy Spirit, the Acts of the Apostles, and the church. And so this is very important for us today, because we're still living in the book of Acts, and we're going to be in the book of Acts till the Lord comes at the rapture of the church and takes us home. So the book of Acts, if you got your Bible, I hope you got your Bible open and a notebook. I always take notes, and the writer of the book of Acts is, of course, Luke. Now, Luke joined with Paul in chapter 16 of Acts. Now, Luke was a historian and he was a physician. Now, I don't know what kind of medical knowledge they had in that time, but he was a physician and he traveled with Paul on two of his missionary journeys, and he was faithful to Paul all the way to the end. And so we're so thankful for Luke and what he did in giving us a historical background in the book of Acts and to the church and all that the apostles did. I want to go now into chapter 1, and I planned initially for about 20 minutes on this, but I don't know. We'll just keep going, then take a break. I want this to be like a Sunday school class, and then we'll take a break and get ready for the worship service. And at 11, I'll come back live at 11 o'clock. In between, Ron Downey is on his Facebook page. He will be singing three or four or five songs. And so if you could get on him, I wish we could get on the same Facebook where we could put it all together. But one day, maybe we will. And also, let me remind you that we have a church website. We're on YouTube and we're on Facebook. And so Mount Carmel Baptist Church, Gadsden, and you can see all of our past teachings and worship services, some of the kids' programs and all. And I appreciate that our music director, Minister of Music, John Jennings, he's the one that's put all of this together. And I really appreciate him doing this, because this is all new to me and I'm enjoying it. And so anyway, I want you to open your Bibles now to the book of Acts, and let's begin reading. We're going to read the first three verses, and then I'm going to come back and talk about those three verses, because like I said, there's so much in this chapter, and I think you're going to learn a whole lot today. All right, let's begin reading with verse 1 of Acts chapter 1. The former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen by them 40 days, speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Now let's break these three verses down and let's see what Luke is talking about here. Now he's writing to a man named Theophilus. Nobody knows who this man is. There's no record of him, and many think that he may have been a Gentile who was supporting Luke financially as he traveled. Now, nobody knows that, but he's writing this, and he sends this, the book of Acts to him, but he's also has sent the former treatise, which is the Gospel of Luke. He has sent the Gospel of Luke to this man, and so this man is pretty important, evidently. But anyway, he goes on and he says, I'm sending this to you about everything that Jesus has done and everything that he taught until he was taken up. Now, the Gospel of Luke gives the life of Jesus. Man goes from the birth. It's very complete on this the writing of Jesus from his birth on to his death and resurrection. But then in chapter 1, Luke continues on in Acts chapter 1, Luke continues on until Jesus is taken up, ascends into heaven. And so as we look at this right here, in verse 3, it says, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. We're going to come and look at that. Being seen by them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Now, before I go to infallible proofs, I want to talk about the 40 days. Why is 40 days important here? Well, it goes back to the feast of Israel, the seven feasts of Israel. Remember, I hope you've seen my study on the seven feasts of Israel. That's why I don't call the resurrection of Jesus, I don't call that Easter, because Easter is from the pagan goddess Ishtar, and it was their worship service. She was the goddess of fertility, and their worship service consists of a bunny rabbits and colored eggs and all like that. That's where we get all of that from, and from the a pagan goddess, the queen. She's called the Queen of Heaven. She's called a lot of other names. Jesus rose on the Feast of First Fruits. And these seven feasts are very important because Jesus had to fulfill all righteousness when he came to John the Baptist to be baptized. He said, John, we must fulfill all righteousness. So Jesus began to sum up the Old Testament. He summed up the law. He fulfilled all of these things. And I wish I have a tendency to repeat, because repetition is the key to learning. And I like to go back and rehearse what I've already taught. But Jesus, at his baptism, started at age 30. He could be he started on the priesthood to fulfill the priesthood, because the high priest had to be at least 30 years old. Jesus could have done everything before age 30, but he waited till he was 30. He was baptized, he was washed, he was anointed, and then he made his way to the cross to become the sacrifice. But Jesus died on the cross on the feast of Passover. And then that evening at 6 o'clock, the Jewish time, began the Feast of Unleavened Bread. It was a very holy Sabbath. Now, it was not a Saturday, it was a Friday. And they had to get him down off the cross, put him in the tomb, and for the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Then Jesus arose from the dead on the Feast of First Fruits. Now, after the Feast of First Fruits, that's three feasts that Jesus fulfilled or did something on. Now, he has taught with his disciples. He's been with them for 40 days. Now, the Feast of Pentecost is the fourth feast, and it occurred 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits. So Jesus waited 40 days, and he's giving them the assignment, and on in the next verse, to wait in Jerusalem for till they be endued with power from on high. That would be the Feast of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, where the Holy Spirit was poured out on that day. So Jesus stayed with them 40 days, then he ascended up into the Father's right hand in heaven. Now there were 10 days left to the Feast of Pentecost. So that's the reason 40 days are so important. Jesus could have done it all before then, but he was fulfilling all of these feasts. And the Feast of Pentecost took place 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits. And so Luke makes it a point to put in that Jesus was with his disciples for 40 days. Now, 10 days, they stayed in the upper room, and we'll get to that later in another time. But anyway, he's talking about his resurrection on the Feast of First Fruits. He showed himself alive by many infallible proofs. What does it mean to be infallible? In other words, you are right. I mean, it is perfect. There's nothing that can say that this is wrong. Everything was perfect. And so what are some of these infallible proofs that proved that Jesus was alive? Well, first of all, the empty tomb. Mary came to the tomb. It was empty. Peter and John ran to the tomb. It was empty. And so the empty tomb is the first proof that Jesus rose from the dead. And then he appeared to his disciples. He appeared to them. In fact, I believe it's tonight when the apostles gathered together the Sunday night after the resurrection, and Jesus appeared to them, but doubting Thomas was not there. We don't know where he was at. I always made a joke. He could have been out barbecuing, could have been out fishing, but he didn't go to church on Sunday night. Man, I love Sunday night church. I always have. Everything is freer on Sunday night. Anyway, Thomas wasn't there. And then he says, I won't believe it unless I feel the nail prints in his hands and then his side. And then the next Sunday night, Thomas was there and Jesus appeared. He says, Thomas, hey, here's the hands. Feel my hands, feel the scars. And Thomas didn't have to do any of that. He just fell at his feet and says, my Lord and my God. He realized that Jesus had come forth and was alive. And so Jesus appeared to his disciples. Now, Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he said that he appeared to up to 500 people. 500 disciples. See, there was a lot of disciples, followers of Jesus, other than this 120 that met in the upper room. And so Jesus appeared to all of them. And then one of the most famous appearances is in the Emmaus Road, where the two disciples were walking and they were discussing the events that had happened. And then Jesus appeared and walked with them and talked with them. And then they evidently did not recognize him at that time, but he left them and they said, didn't our hearts burn within us when he opened up the scriptures? And so Jesus appeared to all of those people. They saw him. And then he also... one of the infallible proofs is there's been 2,000 years of preaching 2,000 years of preaching. And I just don't think anything like that would have lasted if it wasn't true. And so Jesus, churches are all over the world. Christians are all over, all through history. Jesus has been preached and people have believed in him. So that's another infallible proof. But the most important infallible truth is your salvation. You met Jesus and Jesus came into your heart. And so that's the biggest proof right there that Jesus is alive and he's living in our heart and we have his word. So Luke is writing in Acts that Jesus presented himself with infallible proofs that he was alive. Now, to me, that's very, very important. Now, I want to go on just a little bit and get into what I'm going to cover again at 11 o'clock. And let's look at verse 4. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, you have heard from me. Now he's telling his disciples, he said, now go wait in Jerusalem. and you're going to hear, something's going to happen to you. Of course, that's going to be the day of Pentecost. And I'll get into more of this at 11 o'clock. But in verse 5, Jesus said, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. And so that would be 10 days later. So Jesus is telling them, you go to Jerusalem, you wait in that upper room, and there's something going to happen. You're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. I wonder if they even realized what he was saying. But nevertheless, they were obedient. Now turn over in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2, because that's a very important section, and we're jumping way ahead. We'll get to Acts chapter 2 in another lesson. And in chapter 2, verse 1, it says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Now, so they assembled. Now, this was 50 days after the resurrection. This is the Feast of Pentecost. So Jesus is doing something. He's done something on those three feasts, the first three feasts. He's going to do something on this fourth one. And that's, he's going to give the Holy Spirit of God to the Christians, to the believers. Now, the other three feasts, the Feast of Trumpets, I believe that's going to be the rapture of the church. And the Feast of Atonement is the tribulation period where the Jews are repenting of their sins. And then the Feast of Tabernacles will be the 1,000-year millennial reign, the personal reign of Jesus on this earth. Man, I love this. I love how the Bible fits together, because Jesus is fulfilling all righteousness. He's summing up the Old Testament. That's why I love the Old Testament. These people say all you need is the New Testament. Well, sure, but to understand the New Testament, you got to go back to the Old Testament. Man, you put them all together. The Bible is one book, one book. Well, they were in one accord. I love this. They were in one accord in one place. Have you ever been in a church that was having trouble and griping and complaining and fighting? Man, I've pastored churches like that, and I don't want any part of it anymore. And that's why I love Mount Carmel Baptist Church. We don't have that kind of stuff in it. And nobody's been mad at me for 10 years. At least they hadn't told me they have. And so anyway, being in one accord in one place, the Holy Spirit works in that fellowship. that's where the Lord wants to work, where people are together and they love each other and they're in one accord, they're in agreement together. And so this is a beautiful thing that happened on the day of Pentecost. I imagine there was 120 of them in that upper room. That was a big room. And they were gathered together waiting on the promise from the Father, because Jesus said that's what's going to happen. And while they were waiting, and the day of Pentecost had fully come, then it says in verse 2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, at 11 o'clock, we're going to sort of take up with this. I'm going to look at the word baptized and the word filled, because Jesus said over here in chapter 1, he says, when this event happens, he called it the baptism with the Holy Ghost. But when that event happened in Acts chapter 2, when the event happened, Luke did not say baptized with the Holy Ghost. He said they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. So what is the difference? Well, I jokingly say the Pentecostals say baptized with the Holy Ghost, and the Baptists say filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, there's just a play on words. It's the same thing. And so we're going to discuss that more at the 11 o'clock Bible study worship service. And so they were joyous. And also, what was this promise? Jesus says promise it from the book of Joel. Joel chapter 2, verse 28, where Joel prophesied that he was going to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters are going to prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will have visions and all. This is, in fact, Simon Peter over here in, I think it's in verse 16 of Acts chapter 2, said, yes, when he got up to preach, he says, but this is that which was spoken through the prophet Joel. And so at 11 o'clock, we're going to get into that study. So I hope you'll be watching then. Well, this has been a good Sunday school lesson. Well, it's 10:22. I could keep going on and on. And I believe I will. I'm going to go on about 5 more minutes. If y'all got, you know, then that'd give you time, like between Sunday school and church. You got time to go get some water and go to the restroom and all like that. And at home, you get your snack and all like that. So 11 o'clock, you come back and we'll get going again. But anyway, he goes on to say in verse 6, it says, when they therefore were come together, back in chapter 1, verse 6, they asked him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? All right. Well, that's going to be a very interesting topic right there. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. So there's so much to understand in this scripture here. And that's why I say chapter 1 of the book of Acts is so important. And I appreciate everybody watching and all the names of all the people that are responding here. And I hope you've got a blessing from this. I love doing this, but I love assembling together with church. But I love to teach the word. And I really appreciate you watching this morning. I hope this has been a blessing to you. Now, at about 20 to 11 on Ron Downey's Facebook page. I hope you can get on that. Ron will be singing some songs for us. And then at 11 o'clock, I will be coming right back right here. And we will be picking up in Acts chapter 1. And we're going to talk more about being baptized in the Holy Ghost and being filled with the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to add one more thing that the Bible teaches that is not usually mentioned. And it's going to be a very good service, you know. And so anyway, I'm going to close it out right now. And so I hope to see you again at 11 o'clock. The Lord bless you real good. Amen. Good morning again. I hope y'all watched this video, man. It was great. And it's been shared. So look up Ron Downey on Facebook. It was really good. Get you going this morning. Well, if you were with me at 10 o'clock, I was inside my house and I had to move outside because Annette's cooking barbecue chicken and I just couldn't stand it. I was getting so hungry. So I come out here on our front porch and got our church van behind me and everything. It's a little bit cooler out here today. It's about 49 or 50 degrees out here. But anyway, we want to get started right away. And our Bible study, we're going to continue from what we did at 10 o'clock in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 1. And I hope that you are with us today. And I'm so glad that we got so many people watching our videos. And right now, I know Facebook is being filled with preaching and singing and this morning. And like I said, just got through with Ron. Boy, he was good this morning, man. I wish I could hold my breath that long singing and everything. He just did a fantastic job. One of these days, he and I are going to be on the same video page. I hope we can get that worked out and all. But anyway, Acts chapter 1, and I'm not going to review from what we did at 10 o'clock, but we're going to start again with verses 4 and 5. And we're going to talk about being filled with the Holy Spirit and baptized with the Holy Spirit and all of that. And then we're going to look at some other things that go along with that. And so let's begin reading with Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but for the promise of the Father, which saith he, you have heard from John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. And of course, he was talking about the day of Pentecost, the fourth feast. And we were looking at a play on words. Jesus says, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. All right. So now when we look over into chapter 2, when this event happened, it did not say they were baptized with the Holy Ghost. It says they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And I want to look at, this is what I want to share with you this morning, because there's a big significance here. I'm what they call a Baptist-costal, and I've studied with all denominations through the years and studied doctrine and everything. And there's some people come up and say, well, Roger, you need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And I said, well, when were you baptized in the Holy Ghost? They said, well, I was baptized 40 years ago with the Holy Ghost. I said, well, have you been since? Well, it's only a one-time thing. I said, no. No, we're going to show you scripture. And that's why baptized in the Holy Ghost and filled with the Holy Ghost, these are the same thing. It means to be submerged. And what it means is that you have turned your life over to the Holy Spirit of God. Not only that, it means something else. And I'm going to get that in just a minute too. But like I said, the Pentecostals use baptized with the Holy Ghost. Baptists and others use filled with the Holy Ghost. And it's all meaning the same thing. But now when we look in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 18 and 19, and I'm sure you're familiar with this scripture, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 18 and 19, and Paul is writing and he says, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit of God. Speak it to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord. And boy, I believe old Ron was filled with the Holy Ghost this morning singing those songs. Boy, I tell you, you got us all good. But anyway, when you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God, and you want to sing, you want to get happy, and all, and a lot of things happen to you when you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God. But now Paul was writing, and this is not a suggestion, this is a command. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Holy Ghost. It is a command to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. I remember reading the account with Billy Graham, and everybody likes to read Billy Graham's account, but he said when he was young in the ministry, he was preaching a revival at a church. And one of the deacons came in drunk. And he said, boy, the other deacons got a hold of that guy and just chewed him out one side down the other. But Billy Graham, he stopped him. He used this verse in Ephesians. He said, well, you know, it says, be not drunk with wine when it's excess. He says, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. He said, I want to ask every one of you deacons, how many of you are filled with the Holy Ghost right now? You know, and so we could criticize people for being drunk, but how many of us are filled with the Holy Spirit of God every day? I hope I can get into some more of this, because this is just a fantastic teaching. Now, what happened on the day of Pentecost is the prophet Joel, in Joel chapter 2, verse 28, prophesied this, that there's coming a day when God would pour out his Spirit upon all flesh, and your young men will see visions, your old men a dream, and your young men and your daughters will prophesy. So this, I want to look back at the Old Testament. Now, in the Old Testament, only certain people were filled with the Holy Spirit of God. The prophets were, the priests were. And in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come on a person and then would leave that person. And like, if you remember in 1 Samuel, when Samuel prophesied or said to Saul, he says, Saul, you're going to meet some prophets and you're going to be filled with the Holy Ghost and you're going to be turned into a different man. And sure enough, on the road, he met these prophets, and Saul got filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, King Saul did, and he prophesied and he preached and all like that and all. But then later on, the Holy Ghost left him and a spirit of evil came upon him and all. So in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come on people for certain tasks and then he would leave. And remember, David prayed, Lord, take not your Spirit from me. Well, that's the Old Testament. Now, Joel is prophesying in Joel 2:28, that one day he's going to be poured out upon all flesh. And so that's what this is, happened on the day of Pentecost. And Jesus told them to wait in the upper room until you be endued with power from on high. And so they waited, they were in one accord in one place, and the Holy Spirit fell upon all of those people. It says they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And they spoke with other tongues. Now, I'm going to look at this when we get into later on another lesson into chapter 2. But they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And Jesus called it baptizing the Holy Ghost. But when it happened, it was filled with the Holy Ghost. And so here it's a play on words. Now, I want to share with you a couple of things. There are people who say that, you know, you've got to speak in tongues in order to prove that you're filled with the Holy Ghost. That's not biblical. That's not correct. You won't find it in the Bible. They did do that. Some of them did. Some of them didn't. And so it doesn't matter. Whatever the Lord wants to do to you when you get filled with the Holy Ghost, that's up to him. It says the Holy Spirit gives his gifts as he wills. You know, there's some people when they get filled with the Holy Ghost, they're called to preach, and some called to be missionaries, some called to do other things. And there's so many spiritual gifts that tongues is not the only thing that you're going to do. There's some people when they get filled with the Holy Spirit of God, man, they start singing, they start playing music. And I like it's the Holy Spirit wanting to work through you. That's all it is. But there's a reason for this. And I'm going to share that with you in just a minute. The Bible says in Revelation 3:20, chapter 3, verse 20, Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And if any man hear my voice and open up the door, I will come into him and sup with him and he with me." So Jesus doesn't physically come into our heart when we get saved, but the Holy Spirit comes into our heart. Now remember, you are a body, a soul, and a spirit. You are a triune being. And when we get saved, it is our spirit that is in us that is born again. It's the Holy Spirit. Jesus talks to Nicodemus in John chapter 1, John chapter 3, that the Holy Spirit is like the wind. You can't see the wind, but you can feel the wind, and you can see the results of the wind. And so he's comparing that to the Holy Spirit coming into a person's heart, being born again. And we can see the change in a person, but we can't see that when it happens because it's a spiritual thing. And Paul writes that in Romans chapter 8, he writes that if any man have not the Spirit of God, he is none of his. So the Holy Spirit comes into your heart the moment you get saved, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute also. Now, the Holy Spirit comes in us when we get saved, but then in Ephesians 5, it says we are to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Well, what does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God? It means that you have surrendered every part of you to Jesus. And I've used this illustration. Here's somebody in church invites me and Annette over for lunch one day, and we go into their house and they say, "Hey, Brother Roger and Annette, y'all make yourself at home. Make yourself at home. And we're going to go in here and fix some coffee or tea and some drinks and something to snack on. And y'all just make yourself at home." Well, in a little bit, they come in the living room and we're not there. And they wonder where we're at. And they find me and Annette in their bedroom. I'm down on my knees looking under their bed. And Annette's looking in their closet. They said, "What are y'all doing?" I said, "Well, you said make myself at home. I just wanted to look under your bed, see how many shoes you got under your bed. I want to see how much stuff you pile on. I want to see how much dust you got under your bed." "Well, that's not any business of yours. But wait a minute, you said make myself at home." Well, if you say to the Holy Spirit of God, "Lord, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but don't call me to preach. Lord, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but don't call me to be a missionary. Lord, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but don't make me speak in those tongues. Lord, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but leave my social life alone. Leave my work life alone. But I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God." Now, I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to be filled with the Spirit of God. To get filled with the Spirit of God, you got to turn every part of you over to the Lord. "Lord, fill me completely." I turn everything over to you. My finances, my house, my family, I turn everything over to you. My job, fill me with the Holy Spirit of God. I want you to just fill me to overflowing. That's when you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, whatever the Lord does with you after, he may put you teaching a Sunday school class. You never know what the Lord's going to do with you when you say, "Jesus, take over my life. I want to be obedient to you. Just take over me." Well, excuse me. Now, that's, we get the Holy Spirit when we get saved, but yet we want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And being filled with the Holy Spirit is a daily thing. Now, some people say, no, it's not. It's a one-time experience. I beg your pardon. All you have to do is look at Acts chapter 2 when they were filled with the Holy Spirit. Then turn over to Acts chapter 4, verse 31. And they were praying and they were filled with the Holy Spirit again. See, it's not a one-time thing. Being filled with the Holy Spirit is a daily thing. When we get up in the morning, we say, Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit. You don't know what you're going to have to face that day. You may have to go to work with some people that are causing you trouble. You don't know what you're going to face. You say, Lord, I need the Holy Spirit in my life to be filled with the Holy Spirit to just help me to live this very day. And just thank the Lord for it and let him work through you and let him witness through you. And that's another thing we'll get to in later on this week. But then there is something else that we leave out. And turn with your Bibles to John chapter 7, verses 37 and 38, I believe it is. Here in this scripture, it's taking place at the Feast of Tabernacles. And his family wanted to know if he's going. Jesus said, no, he didn't. About 7 days. And on the last day of the feast, the high priest would come out, every day of the feast, the high priest would come out with a pitcher of water, and he would turn that over and pour the water out. He was talking about the prophecy of Joel, that one day the Spirit would be poured out upon all flesh. All right, but then on the seventh day, or the last day of the feast, when the priest come out, he would turn that pitcher of water over and nothing would come out. That would signify that the prophecy of Joel had not happened yet. Well, it was on this last day of the feast that Jesus showed up in John chapter 7. And I can imagine with Jesus standing there, and when that high priest come out and turned that pitcher over and nothing came out, the Bible said that's when Jesus shouted, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. As the scripture says, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. So the whole point is, that spake he of the Holy Ghost that had not been given yet because Jesus had not been glorified. The whole point is this, that the Holy Spirit comes into our heart when we get saved. And we are to be filled daily with the Holy Spirit. But Jesus is saying now, I want the Holy Spirit to flow out of you to other people. That's how we minister to other people. You know, if we keep it all bottled inside of us, nobody else receives the blessing. I'd say sometimes we're like Dead Sea Christians. In the Dead Sea, nothing flows out of the Dead Sea. Everything flows into it. And it's like we go to all the Bible studies. We love the singing. We do all of this. Man, we soak it all up, but we never give anything out. And so Jesus is telling us to let it flow out of us. Let it flow out of us. And that's the Holy Spirit. It flows out of us in many different ways. It flows out of us through ministry. It's flowing out of me right now as I'm preaching. It flows out of you when you teach a class, when you minister to somebody, when you do anything in the name of Jesus, that's the Holy Spirit flowing out of you. And so that's what Jesus was talking about. And I'm going to throw this in there too. It flows out of you when you're singing in church, singing and praising God and saying amen and hallelujah, bless him, Jesus. Boy, that's a great, man, listen, I'm glad I'm a part of a church that can, feels like you say amen. And amen. There's a lot of churches don't want you to make any noise except a holy grunt every once in a while. You know, so we need to let the Holy Spirit flow out of us through singing, through clapping our hands, through dancing, through whatever it is, you know. Let the Holy Spirit flow out of us. Now, I want to get to this beautiful point of why the Holy Spirit fills us, why the Holy Spirit comes into our life. Well, it goes back to the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, when the high priest on the Feast of Atonement, when the high priest, they would wash him and they would anoint him with oil, and he would take the blood sacrifice from that animal off the altar, and he would go into the Holy of Holies. He did that once a year, and they would go behind the veil. Nobody else could go back there. And he would go behind the veil, and he would sprinkle that blood upon the mercy seat. And then when he would sprinkle that blood on the mercy seat, the Shekinah glory of God would come down into that Holy of Holies. Now, it would fill the whole place. Now, that was the presence of God. Holy Spirit of God coming in that Holy of Holies. And it was proof that the Lord had accepted that blood sacrifice for the forgiveness of sin. And so that's why when you open your heart to Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God comes into you right then. The Holy Spirit is proof that God has forgiven you of your sins, and that God has received the blood of Jesus and has washed your sins away as far as the east is from the west, and to be remembered no more. That's why the Holy Spirit is so important. When you open your heart to Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes into you. And then we want to be filled with the Holy Spirit every single day. And we want the Holy Spirit to flow out of us. So whatever term that you use baptized in the Holy Ghost or filled with the Holy Ghost, it all means the same thing. It means that, and in throughout the New Testament, when you study the book of Acts, it says the Holy Spirit fell on them. They received the Holy Spirit. And different words are used for the same thing. And it's just this, when you open your heart to Jesus, he comes into your heart and he forgives your sin. The Holy Spirit is proof in your heart that he forgives your sin. This business of saying that the Holy Spirit don't come into your heart until later as a second blessing, that's just not right. It defeats the whole purpose of the working of the Holy Spirit in your life. The Holy Spirit is proof that your sins are forgiven. Now, I'm going to go on group of people, and I've got good friends that are in this denomination and the Church of Christ. They teach that the Holy Spirit quit working in AD 100 when the apostles were all dead. Well, you can't be saved without the Holy Spirit of God. It's the Holy Spirit of God that brings conviction on you. It's the Holy Spirit of God that does the work in you. And so this business of just being ducked under the water and somebody saying you're saved, that's not it. The Holy Spirit is regeneration. It regenerates you. It makes you alive. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus calls it born again. You are a new creature in Jesus Christ. And it's not just words to be said. It is an actual event. You have been changed. And in Titus 3:5 says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it's the renewing, it's the regeneration and the washing that takes place in our life. That is the working of the Holy Spirit in our life. And so on the day of Pentecost, it was the first outpouring of the Holy Spirit of God, the prophecy of Joel in Joel 2:28. And from then on, everybody, you, Paul says, if you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you are none of his. So folks, when you, if you're not saved right now, when you open your heart to Jesus, Jesus through the Holy Spirit comes into your heart. Now, let me see what time. Oh, we got a little more time. So I hope that you understand that. Now, I'm going to jump down to verse 8, and we're going to come back with verses 6 and 7 tomorrow. Now, tomorrow and Monday through Thursday, the Lord willing, at 10 o'clock, Monday through Thursday at 10 o'clock, I will be teaching at 10 o'clock for about 30 minutes, another Bible lesson. I'm just going to do it because I preach to Annette all the time, and I preach to my cats, and you know, so I need somebody to preach to. So turn in at 10 o'clock and then share these things. The more you share them, the more it gets all over the country. And we got folks from Idaho, Florida, Missouri, everywhere, all over the eastern United States that have been watching. I hope we got some people in Texas, and I hope we got some people in Hawaii that are even watching. And so share these videos, share them several times. So that's the way it keeps going on Facebook. But now, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and Jesus says, "But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." Now, that's what I'm saying. When the Holy Spirit of God comes into your heart, and you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God, here's my cat. He comes up here, and the Holy Spirit witnesses through you. I had a man tell me one time, he drove all the way to Birmingham, where I lived. He drove all the way to Birmingham to tell me that I was not saved. And I said, "Well, why?" He said, "Because you haven't been baptized in our pool by our preacher." And he said, "Furthermore, you can't be a witness for me." I said, "Why?" For a witness for Jesus. I said, "Why?" He said, "Because you were not there when Jesus was alive, and you did not see all those events. So if they were to put you on trial, you would be declared a hearsay witness." I said, "You know, that's crazy." I said, "You know why?" Because the Bible says, I think it's 1 John 5:10, "He that hath the Son has the witness in him." So I wasn't there. I did not see Jesus walking on the earth. I didn't see him crucified. But the one who orchestrated the whole thing is the Holy Ghost, and he lives inside of me, and he is the witness in me, and he witnesses through me of all the events that happened with Jesus. And so that's what Jesus is talking about. You're going to receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. So that's how we go. Somebody says, "Well, Brother Roger, I can't go door to door." I said, "No, you can't. But the Holy Spirit, it goes with you." Man, I tell you what, you think getting on Facebook and preaching live and singing live and all that stuff, you know, that takes something in you. I used to wouldn't do anything like this, you know, but it's the Holy Spirit of God. I remember when the Lord called me into the ministry, I said, "Oh man, I can't do this." You know, but man, when I started doing it, man, the Holy Spirit of God just took over. I remember when the Lord called me to preach, I said, "Man, I probably preached 5 minutes. You know, my first sermon was an hour and a half." So it just started. And that's the Holy Spirit in you. He is the witness in you, and he wants to flow out of you. That's what Jesus said, John chapter 7. So let's think about this. When you get saved, the Holy Spirit is in you, and you need to be filled every single day with the Holy Spirit of God. You need to let the Holy Spirit flow out of you and be free to flow out of you. Say, "Lord, use me. Just use me, because Lord," the Bible, Paul writes that we're the body of Christ. We are his hands. We are his feet. Jesus is the head, and we are the body. So let's do what the head tells us to do, and let's witness for Jesus. Let's be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. And I might as well finish with this too. There are times when when we're not filled with the Holy Spirit of God. There are times when we are in the flesh and the Holy Spirit's still in us, but you know, it reminds me of the story. There was a husband and wife went down during a revival meeting, and they went down in the altar, and she was on one end of the altar and he was on the other end. And he was praying, "Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit. Just fill me to overflowing and fill my saucer too." And she was on the other end of the altar praying, "Lord, don't do it because he leaks." And there are times when we flesh and when the fruit of the Spirit doesn't flow in our life, there are times when we do get in the flesh and we get angry and all like that. That's human nature. And that's what Paul writes about in Romans chapter 7. He says, "The things that I don't want to do, that's what I wind up doing. The things that I don't want to do, I do is what I want to do." And he says, "I find a law when I want to do good, evil is present with me." And so that's the way it is. It's a battle. And I was going to teach on this too one day, the battle of the Christian life. That life, Christian life, is a battle. And once you get saved, you get out of the grandstands. You're not watching anymore. You're on the field playing. And the devil's out there trying to destroy you and tear you up. But thank the Lord that Jesus is there. He's with us. He's living in us. He says, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." We say, "Lord Jesus, forgive me my sins. Forgive me my sins, Lord, and fill me anew with the Holy Spirit of God. Fill me anew." Well, I hope you got a blessing this morning. I sure have. And I just hate that we can't assemble together with each other at church. And I don't know when that's going to be able to happen. It may happen sooner with some groups and all, and than it does with others. But anyway, we can pray for each other and get through this virus and all. And so let's just pray for each other. And 10 o'clock tomorrow I'll be on. So be sure to watch. And I thank you for watching, and thank you for letting me preach this morning to you. And God bless you real good.